41 to 46.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Listen to the words of Christ. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep in his right hand and the goats at his left. And then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Today, before I begin our sermon time together, is a very special Sunday. It's a high holy Sunday of the year. Do you know which Sunday it is?
Christ the King.
Christ the King. Majesty, all glory, Lord and honor, big time celebration. It's also the last experience of this church year, 2017. Next Sunday, we start the church year all over again. And on this Sunday in particular, we pause and recognize the majesty of our King. And so what does it mean to recognize the majesty of Jesus? I have a little bit of a experience for you this Sunday with these words. But first, I wanted to begin with a little reading from one of my favorite theologians, Dr. David Loos. And he says this: one of the central beliefs of Lutheran theology is called theology of the cross. And it means that God regularly, even relentlessly, shows up just where we least expect God to be. Not in Jerusalem or Rome, but in backwater Bethlehem. Not in armor, but in the vulnerable flesh of a babe. Not in conquest, but in crucifixion. Not in power, but in weakness. Again and again, God in Jesus shows up where we least expect God to be, to surprise us, disarm us, and overturn our expectations of glory, so that we might give up our attempts to redeem ourselves and just trust God and his surprising, uncontrollable love. Grace, mercy, and peace to you this day, my friends, in the name of the King of Kings, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Full disclosure, this is not where I wanted to preach. preach from on Christ the King Sunday. It's not the place, it's the text. I don't like the text. Because I wanted I really wanted an impressively exciting text. A text that talks about the return of God in Christ in glory with all the trappings of what glory and majesty seems to mean to us. I wanted to talk to you, my friends. I wanted to review from Holy Scripture for you the stories of the Christ, the King, and all of his majesty and glory, which usually is found more often in Revelation. I wanted to bring about the closing of this church year, because once again, it is the last Sunday of the church year, with a sermon about the majesty and the might of our God. I wanted to celebrate in the coming again of Jesus and all that finery. I needed the gold, I needed the glitz, I needed the bling. Well, when I looked at the text and I realized that I was in the midst of the story of the sheep and the goats from Matthew, my spirit slumped. All I could think of was Pastor Graves' goats. And I thought to myself, whoa, this is just too judgmental a text. This is too threatening. I don't like it. I said to myself, well, where is the grace and the majesty of King Jesus in this text? Where, oh, where is the glory, laud, and honor? Well, then a thought began to form in my mind, and I asked myself a hard question, which usually takes a few days for me as I'm chewing on a text. I don't get up Sunday morning at 5 a.m. and write this. I've been chewing on these words all week long, as I'm cooking a turkey, as I'm tending to my home, as I'm working with churches that are in crisis, as assistant to the bishop, and in the back of my mind is sheep and goats, and what are you going to do with sheep and goats? But the real question was, what am I going to do about the majesty of Jesus? Where is the majesty of Jesus in this text? Was it in the throne room with crowns of glory? Or is the majesty of Jesus found on a cross? Do we see the majesty of God in Christ, in the high and mighty folks of this earth, or in the eyes of the poor and needy? Well, maybe, just maybe, I decided I needed a little lesson myself on the real majesty of Christ, which I will tell you how it came yesterday afternoon, and so last night I had to rewrite my sermon. So I prayerfully began my thoughts on the text, and I began by thinking about the first people who heard these words, the people of Jesus' time. And I found myself as confused as the people in the text when they asked, Lord, Lord, when did we see you hungry? When did we see you thirsty and didn't give you food or drink? Lord, when was it that we saw you as a stranger and didn't welcome you? And when did we see you naked and gave you no clothes? And Jesus, when did we see you sick or in prison and didn't visit you? Well, these first hearers of the word took Jesus, the teacher, the healer, the friend, very literally. And they're wondering, when did he appear to them in these states of need? Many of these folks were very good workers of the vineyard. They cared for the poor, they cared for the widow, they cared for the hungry, the leper, and the imprisoned. That's how these people, the poor people in the time of Jesus, existed, because of the grace and goodness of these people, the sheep, as Jesus calls them. The culture of the day when Jesus was preaching these words for the first time relied on the goodness and the acts of love on the part of those in the community with a willingness, and this is where they can get confused and this is where we can forget. These people had a willingness to see Jesus in the eyes of the needy. In today's text, our confused sheep are attending, feeding, loving, and caring for others with their good works that are overflowing unconsciously from the love of God for them, freely poured into their hearts from God, so that they might tend the children of God, as if these people were Jesus. Let me say that again. people, the sheep, recognized the majesty of God, and they tended the children of God as if they, these needy people, were Jesus. This is how sheep honor and give glory and majesty to the King, by seeing in the needy and the marginalized, the hungry, the poor, the naked, the imprisoned, the eyes of Jesus. And therefore, these folks are greeted with an intense love on the part of the sheep, because it is in the gift of Jesus in these people that they respond, giving majesty to the King. Well, and then this thought came to me. I would say, in fairness, that we are the same sheep today. I think we are the same confused yet loving sheep who long to see Jesus. We just want to see Jesus and do so when we feed, tend, clothe, and care for God's children. I mean, I don't know that we think that way. I think we think we're doing the right thing. But I'm not sure we pause and recognize that we are giving honor, glory, and glory to our King by serving the people of God. I would say that these acts of mercy to others are our acts of love and honor to King Jesus. Now think on this for a moment, because this is a really different place to be with this text. Think on what it might be like for you to look into the eyes of the folks who visit the open kettle as if they were Jesus. Not as if they're poor and needy or hungry, simply as people, but as the opportunity on your part to give majesty to the King by looking deeply into the eyes of these people and seeing Jesus. Here at St. Peter's, I believe we are blessed beyond blessed to give honor and majesty to the King. You feed, you tend, you clothe, you visit. You do the job of the King and give majesty to the King. You care for the lonely. You tend the grief-stricken. You are the good sheep of the shepherd, and I thank you. I believe that we participate in loving acts such as feeding, tending, and clothing, as if Jesus was here in our midst, needing help. I'm going to guess that our extension of care and love to the people of Lantern Hill in Mexico, where Pastor Greg is right now, is done because we are sheep. We are seeking more ways to give honor and majesty to Jesus by tending his sheep. Pastor Greg is in many ways preparing a path for us to continue to love, tend, and feed unconditionally, as if we were tending and feeding our loving Lord in a place that we do not even know yet or haven't even seen, but a place where Jesus nonetheless is. We have our goat moments, though, don't we? And those are the people that are going to sit on the left side that are going to go to an eternal hell and damnation. Ooh. Because they didn't feed, love, care, tend, clothe, visit, etc., etc. Hard text. Hard text. Full self-disclosure, once again. Once a week, I am in Baltimore, down at the our Synod office in a full-day meeting. And I know that my way home will take me past at least three spots where homeless people wait for me to roll down my window and throw out a dollar. And it is so hard because I'm like, oh, if I just get that light green, I don't have to look them in the eye. I miss Jesus. That's what I'm starting to begin to think for myself. I miss the opportunity to give majesty by giving to someone else. So I've decided I'm going to keep a little roll of dollars. I just think that we can, as the goatishness of ourselves, miss many opportunities to not only be kind to those in need, but to be kind to each other. But I decided not to beat you over the head about your goatness. I'm going to give instead glory, laud, and honor to God and praise for your sheepishness. On this day, on this glorious day of the church, when we honor the majesty of God in Christ, I give thanks to God that we can come before him in our sheep-like acts, not out of personal praise or aren't we good, but rather in all humility, because we had the opportunity to look into Jesus' eyes as we fed and clothed and tended. And that my prayer for all of us is that with a new year ahead, we have a commitment to minimize our goat-like tendencies and to remember to be the sheep of the King. Yes, today is Christ the King Sunday. We give honor to the King. Let us seek ways to serve him and to serve each other, to continue to live out the glory of the King. The King that has a true majesty found in the marginalized. The King that has true majesty on the cross and a crown of thorns. And now I have the story that you need to hear that caused me to rewrite the sermon. I'm hearing something. Did I do something?
No.
Okay, fine. I just want to make sure I didn't touch something that I shouldn't. In closing, really, this is brief, but it's very, very powerful. Whenever a pastor preaches and prepares a document to be a proclamation on the Word of God, it's really helpful in some way, shape, or form you feel affirmed in that message. Not just from you going, oh, that was really nice, Pastor Betty, but rather that somewhere during the week you know that the work you're doing either needs change or needs to be retouched. So one of the things that happened to me yesterday when I thought I had it in the can, as it were, ready to go, we went and visited a friend of ours who is a businessman in Bethany, and he won't let me use his name, but I will tell you he's a good man. He's a good Catholic, and he is a faithful worshiper of the King. And we were talking, and he was just wanted to tell me, Pastor Betty, about the story about what happened to him. And he wanted to tell me the story because he was so moved by it. And he came to me and he said, as we're talking and buying something from his store, I gotta tell you what happened to me. He said, there's a man that walks around the streets of our community and he looks homeless and needy. He looks cold. He looks like he could use a good meal. He looks like he could use a good coat, a pair of shoes. He said, and the first time I met him was the other day because I had to stop because he looked so familiar to me. And he thought, I don't know of anybody, he said to me, that might be in that type of condition. He said, but I was absolutely just overwhelmed with the need to stop and roll down my window and say, hey, friend, how are you? He said, I wanted to see him close up. I want to do the eye-to-eye thing, he told me. He said, because I know that I knew this man. And so we went, he said, so I finally one day just drove up, rolled down the window, and said, hi, I'm who I am. And he said, hey, would you like a ride? It's cold out here today, walking around without a coat on. Can I help you? And the man said, yes, he'd appreciate that. And with that engagement, my friend is still going, why do I feel like I know this person? But once he got past needing to know, he got engaged with the individual and took him to help him get his car fixed so he could drive, made sure he had food for the day, found out he does have a place to live, but he didn't have a coat, and just did this wonderful one-to-one sheepish thing, all the time saying, Pastor Betty, it kept bothering me because I know this man. And And I'm standing there, and all these people in the store, and I'm thinking in my head of this text, and I said to him, friend, I said, did you see Jesus on the street? And his eyes opened, and he said, you know, maybe that's what it was. Maybe that's why I was drawn to him. I sensed God. He said, I don't know why, so we did a little back and forth chatting. He said, I saw in his eyes my Lord. Starting to get a little teary-eyed. I started getting a little teary-eyed, and I'm thinking, there goes the sermon. And I thanked him for his honesty, and I thanked him for his kindness, and I thanked him for being one of God's sheep and for giving me a close to this sermon that reminds you in all of our faces, in all of our eyes, rests the majesty of the King, and we are called to serve in that way and in that place. May God bless you to do so in your year ahead. Amen.
Amen.